Guys, you're back learning about purge and trap technology. And in the previous video, we just went through the sparger tube. And we talked a little bit about the purge process. Not in detail, but we said, hey, listen, helium gets pumped in through the sample. That helium is purging or pushing all of the VOCs out of the sample, and those VOCs have to go somewhere. So where do they go? They go to the trap, and they begin to get loaded up on this trap, ready for the next step. All right, so after the purge is over with, the machine kind of cuts this line off. It doesn't really want the sample to go back into that U-tube or that sparger tube, so it has to prevent that sample from going back to where it came from. In the next step, what happens is that we've got to release all of these compounds on the trap. And the easiest way to do this is through a little bit of heat. All right, let's use some common sense here. These things are volatile organic compounds. Volatile means they're going to evaporate easily. Volatile means that I shouldn't probably have to heat this stuff up very hot in order to get these compounds to evaporate on me yet again, right? They were already doing it naturally in the sample. No big deal. They were already doing it. I just helped this process along a little bit, and I helped to push almost all of the sample out of the aqueous environment through this purge. Now that they're trapped, they're still volatile. Nothing's going to change about their chemical or physical properties. So what happens is that I apply a little bit of heat to this column. So that means that this thing probably has to be in an oven. It has to be in a heated chamber. And this tube will eventually get heated to a hot enough temperature that these volatile organics are starting to come off of the column at this point. All right, so eventually what happens is that these components will leave the column, and in one big fat cluster, they kind of get loaded up here at the end to get ready to go into the GC instrument. So when the purge tells the GC instrument, hey, I've done my job and I'm finished, then all of a sudden the GC will open up the inlet and it will allow the rush of the volatile organic compounds to come through. And now they begin to get measured. Not only that, but this is in a concentration that is very acceptable to the GC. I've just kind of condensed my sample down. That's really what I've done here, right? I've taken this water sample that had water in it. I couldn't inject it anyway, but this is kind of diluted. And what happened is that I pushed all of those volatiles out and trap them, and because that I've trapped the majority of it. And now that I've trapped the majority of it and then heated it up, they're coming off in a big cluster. All of the components are coming off in a big cluster, and that eventually is going to go to the GC, and then the separation of the GC is going to happen, and then the detection of the compounds are going to happen. As you can imagine, the oven temperature is pretty important here. So I want to make sure that I choose a proper temperature for this process to take place. If I don't heat this stuff up hot enough, then some of those volatile organic compounds can stay behind. And if those VOCs stay behind, what will happen is that it will cause contamination issues, or I will not be able to measure everything in that sample. There could be stuff in that water sample that needs to be detected, but because it did not come off of the trap, I'm never going to see it in my instrument. So the temperature has to be hot enough, and again, the method will tell you typically what this temperature should be. For the most part, you normally would see about 150 to 200 degrees set in the desorb mode, and that's exactly what this is called. So we call this the trap, but the process of releasing it from the trap is called the desorb. So I'm desorbing, in a way, the VOCs from the trap. I'm releasing them so that way they can go through the instrument and be seen by the detector. So here's the updated purge and trap system that you would see from Teledyne Tekmar. It looks about the same. There's not too much stuff that's going on here. If you look behind the smoke screen, you can see the sparging tube that's right here. It's the shape of a glass U-tube. And there's some connector pieces on both ends, and the trap is on the inside of the box, of course. But that's all that the purge and trap system is. That was really no different than this Teledyne Tekmar Stratum model, which is what we have in our lab. And you can easily see the sparging tube right there, front and center of where it needs to be. So you visually can see the helium getting bubbled through your sample. You can see those bubbles kind of escaping, all of the volatiles leaving that sample and then getting trapped in the column on the inside of the system. So there's the Stratum model. And this is the newest model as of today, and this is called the Lumen model. If you go up here to the products and you go back to volatile organic compounds here, you're also going to see an auto sampler. And they have these two that's called Aquatech LVA auto sampler, and then you see an Aquatech 100 auto sampler. If I click the Aquatech 100, this is the system that you're going to see, and this is just the auto sampler that goes along with the purge and trap unit. So you typically see this round turntable, and you would put all of your samples, maybe they're all water samples, and you're measuring pesticides, who knows? But all of those get loaded up onto the tray, and this auto sampler needle will go from one vial to the next, and it will go in order, and it will sparge them, and it will take them into the sparger, and it gets rid of the volatiles, and it measures them. Everything is very much automated nowadays, and that's the great thing about this auto sampler unit. If you look here in the front, you see two vials that are kind of up front and personal with you. And those two vials are for internal standards. So you can load the internal standard solutions up into these vials. And I guess this one could be two different ones. And this auto sampler will not only inject automatically the sample for you, but it will also put the internal standard into the sample and then inject that mixture for you as well. So if you do have to do internal standard studies, this makes your sample preparation very easy. You tell it how much you want it to inject, it injects that amount in every single sample, including your standards, so that way you can kind of determine if your sample is getting lost at any point in time. Through the auto sampling technique, through the purging technique, through the desorption technique, and then on into the GC system. There's a lot of steps, there's a lot of tubing, there's a lot of things that go on. So it's going to be very easy for us to lose sample along the way. So that's why internal standards are heavily recommended here using the purge and trap system. If I go to this Aquatech LVA auto sampler, I'm going to go to this thing, and a picture is going to show up, and it looks a little different. Here I see the auto sampler vials again, but instead of a round table that turns, this needle basically just goes back and forth and up and down, and it will go to the proper vial that you need. And again, you see the internal standards that kind of stick up here at the very top. So the technology is basically the same. This one's traditionally a little bit smaller. It doesn't have or it doesn't hold as many samples as the previous one. So this one's probably a little bit cheaper and easier on the pocket because of that, but the idea and the concept is the same. It does the same process. There's no different. And here you kind of see the purging unit that would take your sample on top of the auto sampler unit. So there's the whole shebang, I guess that you could say. Here's the auto sampler where you would load your samples up. There's the internal standard vials that would inject the internal standard into your samples. And then these samplers are getting sucked up and they go into the sparging unit, which is right here for you. So that's kind of the whole system as in total that you would see it in a lab. Under the discontinued products, this is our Stratum purge and trap concentrator here, which is the older model for it. And our auto sampler, because we do have one on this system, is the Aquatech 70 vowel auto sampler. So this is what you're going to see in our laboratory. It's an Aquatech. It's just an older version of an Aquatech. It looks a little bit different, but it still does the same thing. And this Aquatech 70 is going to load the sample vowels up into two trays for us, and the needle will slide back and forth and up and down to go to the proper vowel, and it will suck the sample up through the vowel and send it directly into the sparger unit for us, so that way the purge and trap process can begin. Here in the very front, you see this vowel that's present, and that vowel is for an internal standard. So we do still have that technology with the outdated, apparently, auto sampler here, and we still can process samples the same way, but for some reason, according to them, they've made this process a little bit better and a little bit easier. Off of this auto sampler, you're also going to see a water jug, all right? So here I'm going to clear the screen out so that way I can kind of draw some pieces. Here I'm going to draw the auto sampler. So I'm just going to call it auto here. And the auto sampler is going to be connected to the sparger unit. So this is what people would refer to as our traditional P&T purge and trap system. This requires a needle. And this needle will need to be cleaned in between the different samples that I'm pumping into the system. So over here to the side, what you're not seeing in these pictures is typically a water reservoir. And the water reservoir is really there to help flush the entire system out. So the water reservoir goes into the auto sampler, and the very first thing that it does is that it rinses the needle. This needle that goes from sample to sample or from standard to standard has to be cleaned. It has to be rinsed. You have to get rid of everything that was there from the previous run. So that rinse water is going to be there, and that's the reason that it's getting used. So number one, it cleans out the auto sampler system. Without a clean needle, you're going to get some cross-contamination that can happen, and you want to prevent that. All right, number two, what can happen is that this water reservoir can also flush out the trap, and it can flush out the purging. If you've set it up that way, this thing can take water, it can go through, it can do some rinse cycles or wash cycles, if that's the way that you want to think of it, and all of it basically goes out. So it keeps the entire system very clean. Keep in mind that we are measuring volatile organic compounds, and these volatile organic compounds are getting measured on a part per billion level. So fractions of a compound that get left behind can actually be affecting your data by the end of this result. And we do not want that affected. So this entire system has to stay super, super clean. Not only that, but the vowels that you begin to use for the purge and trap, typically they are one-time use. And that is the reason, because once you put sample in them, you've now contaminated that glass vial. And that glass vial is going to basically have volatile organics in it for quite some time unless you super, super clean them and get rid of every single thing that you can. Typically, these vials, if they are going to be reused, needs a complete washing by you by hand, and then they are normally put in some type of sonicator device, and that will basically loosen up any kind of volatile that still might be present. Gets it out of the nooks, it gets it out of the crannies, it gets it out of the etchings in the glass, and all of that can basically dissolve up into the solvent that you put these vials into. So this whole cleaning process is very, very strict because, again, we're working on part per billion and maybe even part per trillion levels, and any kind of contamination will affect our numbers. It will affect our calibration curves, our data is not going to make sense, and we're going to have issues over it. That's also another reason that this water reservoir goes into a heated chamber. So you are using hot water here, hot water. So all of that is going to not be boiling, but it's going to be pretty warm and pretty hot. So if you think about yourself in the morning taking a hot shower, this is basically the temperature that you might see this hot water being pumped through the system in order to help clean it out as much as possible before the next run begins to hit. So part per billion levels, it has to be rinsing all over the place. Make sure you take a look at the water reservoir. Make sure that it stays full. And if you're getting contamination, this could be one of the reasons. It's your vials. So one-time use, throw them away and get new ones for the next run. I know that seems wasteful, but when we're working at these super low concentrations, well, that's just kind of what we have to deal with. So one of the things that you might see that's uploaded into the Blackboard site that comes along with the Purge and Trap folder will be the Aquatech 70 Liquid Auto Sampler User Manual. So I'm putting the manual up not because I want you to read page by page by page, because there's tons of pages. There's 119 of them. But I just kind of want you to maybe open it up at least one time and just kind of skim through it and see what they're telling you about the auto sampler and maybe how they take care of it and how to troubleshoot it and how to make sure it stays clean. But it's going to go through, and it's just like an instruction book for any kind of electronic that you buy at your home. You're probably not going to read it word by word, but you can at least flip through it, look at the pictures, and see any big warnings that might be present that's there. If you look at the instruction book for the auto sampler unit, you're going to see it broke down into a couple of different things. You're going to see the system setup, which is basically connecting it out of the box for the very first time. Chapter 3 is using the tech link and processing samples. So this is the software that makes this process run. So how to use some of that software for the auto sampler, and how do you process samples the proper way. Chapter 4 is maintenance and troubleshooting. So what are some of the common problems that we would see with the auto sampler side, and how do we fix those? And then Chapter 5 are basically diagrams that come along with how this whole thing begins to work. So again, I'm not telling you to read it all, but I am asking you to kind of at least open it up and look at it, and you're going to see some assignment questions that will come from this manual. So you know as good as well as I do, if I'm not asking you to read it all, those assignments are going to direct you to a couple of different pages that you need to pay attention to. The assignment's probably not going to be timed. You're going to be allowed to flip through and find the answers as you need them. And then that way you can take your time, read through pieces. If you need some extra time to find some answer to some questions, you've got that process down, right? So this is to come. Is there anything that I need to kind of basically point out to be very kind of clear about any kind of problems or anything as you use this auto sampler? So the first thing that we can take a look at is what you're seeing here in the picture in the middle of the screen. And this is the auto sampler, of course, because we're looking at the auto sampler instruction manual. And then up here at the very top to the side, this is just the simple little needle that will pierce the septum of your container or your vial that you have your sample in. And of course, this needle is going to have to be changed over a course of time. It's going to constantly get clogged up, or it's going to get contaminated, or you're going to get some carryover at some point in time. And these things aren't going to last forever. The needles are really easy to change, though. You're basically going to see a screw here, which is a tightening screw, and then one on top. So the only thing you got to do is just unscrew the screw and then slide the needle out of its holding port, put the new one in, and then tighten the screw back. So this is going to be something that's very simple and easily done. Up on top, this, what you're seeing here on the screen, basically at spot number one, you see kind of the small peg that's sticking up out of the top. That actually goes to a piece of tubing. So the sample is going to be sucked up through the needle, and it's going to have to go somewhere. And eventually it's going to make it to the purge chamber or the sparger piece of glassware. And that piece of tubing is going to be connected up here at the very top of the syringe. So, of course, you would have to disconnect that piece before you put the new syringe on and then secure it back to the new syringe when that piece does get changed out. So, no big deal, pretty simple. It's just a matter of seconds, really, and that's all there is to it. So, very easily done. Anyone can do it. It takes less than 5 minutes to do it with, but it is something that constantly needs to be looked at over a course of time, especially if you're running pretty nasty or pretty dirty samples. Some of these screens and pictures that you're going to see in the manual are going to look like this. And this is the sparger unit or the sparger tube, that kind of U-shaped tube that's there that will eventually get your sample and hold it. And this long needle is basically going to be the line for the helium. What these diagrams are basically showing you is how to connect the auto sampler to the sparger tube. So they're kind of pointing out the junctions. They're pointing out the nuts and the bolts of the machine and kind of telling you how to hook it up, the proper ways to hook those pieces up, and then maybe some troubleshooting techniques that could happen at these areas that you're going to have to tighten or loosen, maybe, depending on what you've done with it. In the software system that operates the auto sampler, you're going to see the screen basically show up two different things, which mean completely different things. But a lot of people assume that it's the same, and it is not. So the words that I want you to focus on here is the word method and the word schedule. So in the purge and trap system, and again, this is one of the most common purge and trap systems that are out there by Teledyne Tecmar, there's going to be two versions, a method and a schedule. The way that I want you to think about this is that the method will give you the parameters. So that's all of the temperatures, all of the flow rates that the machine is going to require at some point in time. You're going to have to enter those in, especially if you follow a method. You want to double check these settings to make sure that they are the same. So these are the parameters of the instrument. So whenever we set the parameters, and there's tons of them, by the way, and we'll take a look at this eventually, but whenever we set the parameters, we're going to save these parameters. That way we do not have to go through and key them all in again the next time we run a sample. When we save them, these are called a method. So we can have method files. This is something that you would see in a GC system. It's something that you would see in any of our other pieces of equipment. These are just the parameters of the machine. That way you can open those up and those are already entered and they're ready to go. And you do not have to waste your time to enter those all over again. The schedule is something a little different, but it's maybe something not foreign to you at this point. The schedule is just basically the auto sampler table. That's all that it is. So in the software, if you want to key in all of your samples, and this would be your sample names and your sample IDs, especially if they have barcodes, whatever the case is, this is going to be the schedule. So you tell it where the samples are located, which is also the vial number. So all of that information goes into the system. You can save all of that information once you've keyed it in. So for instance, sample or vial number one is going to have a blank. Vial number two will be sample IB. Vial number three would be sample 4A. Whatever the case is, that data gets entered in, and that is what we refer to as a schedule. It's just an auto sampler table. That's all that it is. So once this gets keyed in, you always want to save that schedule. So that way, if something happens later down the road, you can just simply open this batch up and all of that information will be entered and you can just kind of rerun it if that's what you need to do. So please do not take all the time and enter that stuff in and not save it. That would be like writing a term paper in English and then just hitting the X button after you get finished. You don't do that. You want to save that information so that way you can pull it back up at a later time. So that's the difference in the terminology between the word method and the word schedule as far as the instrumentation goes. Here's another page in the instruction manual. And this is section 3.7. And if I kind of read the steps 1 through 7, they're giving you a general overview of what you should be doing in the auto sampler tray. So step number 1 says you need to start the thing up. So make sure the power buttons are on to the pieces of equipment and the auto sampler, and then turn on the TechLink software. So that means double click the icon on the desktop of the computer and activate the software that will control the instrumentation. Number 2, it says load or create the method file. So the very first thing that I would want to do is load the method file up, and I want to check those parameters to make sure that they are legit and that they're the right ones that I should be using. And then if they are, I can just close that method file back out because I really don't need to do anything else with it at that point. If I need to create a method, now's the time to do that. So that way when I start running samples, I can tell it what parameters I want those samples to be analyzed with. Number 3 says use the schedule worksheet to basically do your auto sampler table. So at this point is when I would open up the auto sampler table or the schedule. I would key in the vial numbers, I would key in the names, and then I would apply the sample to the method that I would want to use. Number 4 says prepare and load the samples into the racks. Just make sure that you enter them into the rack just like you've entered them into the software. Number 5 says prime the sample module, and number 6 says prime the sample module water. So one is the internal standard, which is IS, and one of them is going to be water. And then number 7 says click start. So I want to talk about the priming issue with the auto sampler first. So prime just basically means gets it ready. That's all that it does, okay? So if you prime the internal standard, the I and the S is internal standard. If you've taken the CTC 150 class, which is the standards and solutions, you're familiar with this term. If you haven't taken that course yet, what the internal standard means is basically a standard, which means that you know what is there that is added to the samples and the standards in the same amount across the board. Everything gets the same amount of this component. That way you know it's going to show up, you know it's going to be present, you know that the area should be the same in every single sample and every single standard. And if it is not, let's say the area plummets in one sample or the area is shot through the roof in another sample, well, that means there's something wrong with your auto sampler. The needle has sucked up too much, or the needle did not suck up anything at all for that particular sample or that particular run. It just gives us some confirmation that the auto sampler is working the proper way and everything is legit in the system. So this priming basically means it gets all of the air out of the line. So if I take the vial off of the machine and I fill it up with my internal standard and I put the vial back onto the front, I'm probably going to stick a tube down into that vial and I tighten the cap up here at the very top. The problem is that when I do that, I have introduced air into the system. So the priming part is basically taking this piece of tubing and sucking up internal standard and basically getting rid of it. It's just flagging it through the tubing, getting rid of all of the air bubbles, and then out of the instrument it goes. It does not read it, it does not see it, and it gets the line and the tubing ready for the actual analysis part that's about to begin. The same thing is going to happen with priming the water line. Remember, I told you that there was a water reservoir over here to the side, and that water needs to be sucked up, and it's eventually going to go through the needle of the auto sampler tray, and it's also going to go through other components of the instrument. If you take this lid off of the reservoir and you fill it full of water because maybe it's low, and then you put the lid back on, what you've done is that you have incorporated air into the system, and you do not want those air bubbles that are trapped behind in the tubing lines. So if you prime the water, what happens is that you are sucking up water and you're flooding the instrument all of the tubing of the instrument with the water, so it will push out all of those air bubbles that might be present. So it's a very good way to basically get the tubing lines ready to go, so that way you're not experiencing any type of hiccup throughout this process. So priming is going to be important, and it should be something that you do before you start every single method. So that means, even if I've used it before, I need to get myself into the habit of maybe loading up some samples before I start the batch. Just go ahead and prime the internal standard line and prime the water. Even if you think it doesn't need it, it's not going to hurt it. So go ahead and prime everything out, have it ready to go, and that way that could cause you or prevent you problems further down the road. Finally, on the back end of this lab or this instruction manual, you're going to see section number 4, which is maintenance and troubleshooting. So as I scroll through here, it's going to basically tell me some of the common problems that might be seen with the auto injector, and then how can I fix those as an analyst to prevent some of those things from happening again in the future. So remember, this is really specifically tailored toward the auto sampler and not the purge and trap concentrator. That will have its own instruction manual that we'll cover in the next video, but right now we're just looking at the components of the auto sampler itself. One of the most common things that will happen as far as troubleshooting goes will be this thing called the leak or the leak check. So all of this is really driven by gas, right? Gas is going into the system, gas is coming out of the system, it's volatile organics that we're capturing. So everything has to be completely leak free. And you're going to have a piece of the software system that says leak check. What I want you to focus on here, which is probably one of the most important things, is that you should be leak checking the machine every single day. And it just requires the push of one button, and that's it. So on the screen, what you're seeing over here to the left are certain things that could cause a leak in your system. So causes of leaks typically include the following: a very loose nut. So if I didn't tighten maybe something up as tight as it should go, then this is going to allow air to come in, or it's going to allow helium and sample to leave out. A ferrule, which is the fitting inside of the nut, that over a course of time is going to get wore down. It's going to get warped, it's going to get damaged, and it can begin to leak. A break or a hairline crack on the pneumatic line. This also is going to be as far as the sparger tube as well. So I want to make sure that nothing really is happening in there that, again, I'm losing sample with or it can't hold pressure. And finally, a fitting. So maybe I was in there and I was doing something and I put the wrong fitting back on and I thought that it was going to work and it just really isn't the right one. Any of those is going to cause a problem in your system, and you can detect if any of those are going to be a problem by doing the leak check. But keep in mind, it says the concentrator, the sample module, and the auto sampler need to be on at least 30 minutes before you leak check the system. So what that means is that you should not be going in, flipping the power buttons on, opening up the software, and immediately performing a leak check. You need to wait at least 30 minutes to an hour before you attempt this. It's got to get the flow going, it's got to receive some of the helium, it's got to kind of equilibrate itself a little bit, and you cannot do a leak check right off the bat. If you decide to do that, it's going to kick back an error, and it's going to tell you that there is a leak in place, when in actuality, there's not a leak at all, maybe. So just give us a little bit of time, right? Don't be in a hurry. Kind of take care of it, and it will take care of you. If you leak check the system and it passes, then that means your samples are probably not going to leak out of the system, of course. If you leak check the system and you get an error, it's going to tell you that there was an error. And then you need to go back and you need to take a look at these pieces up here at the very top. And finally, the end of this instruction manual is going to give you some diagrams. Now, I don't want you to really memorize these diagrams. They are basically here at the end to give you an idea of flows. So what's going on at different stages throughout the purge and throughout the trap? Up here at the very top, you're going to see the different stages, and this is going to lead us into the next one. These different stages will be standby, preheat, pre-purge, purge, desorb ready, and then finally bake. So what they're going to do toward the end of this is give you different ones that basically tell you where the helium is going, how the flow is going through the instrument. That way you can kind of get a better idea of what's happening at that stage of the game. So for instance, here is the flow diagram of something that we would see in the filling the internal standard step of this whole process. And as we go through, that process changes. Those steps are doing something different. Therefore, our flow lines are going to be different. So if you take a look, here's this blue line that comes through, and we see some green lines that come through here and some light blue lines that go up through the top. And then in the bake transfer, you're seeing some of these basically closed off. They're different colors. They're not evident. They're not highlighted. And we're going to talk more about these different stages of the PTC a little bit later on in another video. So that's what here is at the very end. This really is auto sampler, but it's also more purge and trap related as well. So you're going to be able to find some of that information here at the back of the manual. So with that said, I think that this lab video is now done. I think that we have a better understanding of the auto sampler. I think we have an understanding of what to do and how to prime it and get it ready to be used. Keep in mind, the water reservoir always has to be filled, and that water reservoir should be primed before we use it. The internal standard, if we're using one, and you're highly encouraged to, should also be primed. And the difference between the method and the schedule nomenclature. So we've took about 35-40 minutes here just talking about the auto sampler side of the house. It is pretty important. If the auto sampler doesn't work the proper way, then your machine's not going to make any sense at all when it begins to analyze the samples. So if this falls or fails, then everything else will fail accordingly. So in the next video, we're going to focus more on the purge and trap side, and we're going to define these stages and give them proper names and take a look at that instruction manual as well. So your job with purge and trap is not yet finished, but you're getting closer and closer there.